Random House Audio presents A World on Fire by Amanda Foreman. Read for you by Robertson Dean. Preface. Some years ago, while researching the life of Georgiana, Duchess of Devonshire, I learned that her great-nephew, later the 8th Duke of Devonshire, had spent Christmas Day 1862 making eggnog for the Confederate cavalry officers of General Robert E. Lee's army. I hope Freddie, his younger brother, Lord Frederick Cavendish, won't groan much over my rebel sympathies, but I can't help them, he wrote to his father 3 days later. The people here are so much more earnest about the war than the North seems to be. I was aware that the American Civil War had sharply polarized public opinion in Britain. My original doctoral thesis had examined attitudes toward race and color in pre-Victorian England, but it was still a shock to discover that the heir to the greatest liberal peerage in England thought the slaveholding South had the moral advantage over the anti-slavery North. Understanding how the Confederacy had managed to achieve this ascendancy, not only with the Duke, but also with people who might generally be considered as belonging to the progressive classes in Britain, journalists, writers, university students, actors, social reformers, even the clergy, became one of the driving obsessions behind this book. My original intention was to write a history of the British volunteers who fought in the Civil War. I had assumed that by examining their reasons for joining the Union or Confederate armies, I would gain an insight into the forces that had shaped public opinion. But once I began, the book refused to stay within its intended confines, especially as it became clear that these volunteers were part of an Anglo-American world that was far greater and more complex than I had ever imagined. It gradually became a biography of a relationship, or more accurately, of the many relationships that together formed the British-American experience during the Civil War. The war began on April 12, 1861, when Confederate troops fired on the Federal garrison at Fort Sumter in Charleston, South Carolina. The ensuing four-year struggle would lead to the freedom of 4 million slaves and cost the lives of more than 620,000 soldiers and 50,000 civilians. President Abraham Lincoln responded to the attack on Fort Sumter by calling for 75,000 volunteer soldiers and declaring a blockade of southern ports. Across the Atlantic, however, Lord Palmerston's liberal government was chiefly concerned with ensuring that Britain did not become embroiled in the conflict. There was too much at stake. The livelihoods of nearly 1 million workers depended on southern cotton, while British investors held $444 million worth of U.S. stocks and securities. On May 13th, reflecting a rare moment of unanimity between Parliament, the press, and the public, Queen Victoria issued a proclamation of neutrality, which recognized that a state of war existed between the Union and the Confederacy and forbade British subjects to take part. But this well-meaning act had precisely the opposite effect of what was intended. Each side accused Britain of favoring the other. The North threatened to invade Canada in retaliation. The South used every legal loophole to build its warships in British dockyards, and Britons ignored the injunction against interfering and volunteered by the thousands in the Union and Confederate armies. Twice in 4 years, Britain and the North were on the brink of war. The first time, in December 1861, British troops were halfway to Canada by the time the two governments backed down. Biography is a subset of history, yet it stands independently too. The most obvious difference is that biographers delve deeply into individual lives and the influences that shape them, whereas for historians, it is the sum of individual experiences that is important. In A World on Fire, I have tried to combine both approaches. I decided from the beginning to treat each of the significant figures in the story, and many of the lesser ones, as though he or she was the principal subject of the book, so that I could understand the antecedents of their motives and decisions during the Civil War. This not only added several years to the project, but also created the problem of how to construct a single narrative out of competing points of view within a time frame that encompassed multiple simultaneous events. The challenge seemed insurmountable, until one day I remembered having seen Trevor Nunn's 1980 Nicholas Nickleby, an extraordinary theater-in-the-round production that brought together a vast panoply of characters through a combination of three-dimensional staging, shifting scenes, and running narratives that created an all-enveloping experience for the audience. This memory became my guide and inspiration, and I set about writing a history in the round in hope of immersing the reader inside the British-American world of the Civil War. I was fortunate that many areas of this world had already been researched by Brian Jenkins, Howard Jones, R.J.M. Blackett, Charles Hubbard, D.P. Crook, Frank Murley, Warren F. Spencer, Norman Ferris, and others. My debt to their pioneering work cannot be overstated. Any omissions or errors in the book are mine alone. I am deeply grateful to Eve and Michael Williams-Jones, Hugh DeBruhl, Jonathan Foreman, Brian Jenkins, James McPherson, Christopher Mason, Michael Music, Frederick Smoller, and Richard Snow for their help and criticisms of early versions of A World on Fire. The book took 12 years to complete, and I owe heartfelt thanks to Andrew Wiley, Sarah Chalfont, and Jeffrey Pasternak of the Wiley Agency for their loyalty during all that time. True to the spirit of the book, A World on Fire was simultaneously edited by Susanna Porter at Random House in New York and Stuart Prophet at Allen Lane in London. It has been a profoundly rewarding and intellectually satisfying process to work with them both. Over the years, I have benefited enormously from the help and guidance provided by librarians and archivists all over the world. My family have been a tremendous support to me, but there is one person who, above all, made this book possible, and that is my husband, the center of my world. Prologue. Farewell to Lord Napier. Lord Lyons puzzles Washington society. Rocky relations between Britain and America. Washington society adored the Napiers. From the moment they had arrived at the British legation in 1857, Lord Napier was hailed as the friendliest and most sensible diplomat ever to set foot in the capital. For her part, Lady Napier soon won her own following as a hostess of unparalleled warmth and grace. Her cozy at-homes were remarkable for their informality, recalled a Southerner after the war. Their presence was considered essential at any fashionable gathering. The legation was neutral territory, and one met there the talented and distinguished, heard good music, listened to the flow of wholesome wit, and enjoyed delectable repasts. A feeling of universal regret spread over the capital when it became known that the Napiers were to return to England. Senator William Henry Seward of New York, Lord Napier's closest friend in Washington and the heir apparent to the Republican leadership, invited a small group of senators to join him in organizing a farewell ball. The committee had hoped to control the number of guests by charging $10 per person, equivalent to $1,700 in today's money, but the heady combination of popularity and power resulted in no fewer than 1,800 subscriptions for the gala. Only one venue other than the White House could accommodate so large a gathering, Willard's Hotel on the corner of E and 14th Streets. The New York Times joked that a ticket to the Napier Ball was harder to come by than a front row seat at the current Broadway hit comedy Our American Cousin by the British playwright Tom Taylor. On February 17, 1859, the Grand Ballroom at Willard's was specially decorated with an Anglo-American theme. Flags and mirrors lined the walls, and two large portraits, one of George Washington, the other of Queen Victoria, hung majestically from the ceiling. A representation of St. George and the Dragon, made of sand, covered the floor. It was, however, the lavish banquet that created the most excitement. The chef had fashioned the Napier's coat of arms out of spun sugar, as well as dolphins in a sea of rock candy and ices in every form, from a pair of turtle doves to a pillared temple. The Napiers made their appearance at 9:45 p.m. to the strains of God Save the Queen and were greeted with loud cheers and applause. Their evening dress was decidedly old-fashioned according to American tastes. Boldly resisting the trend among men for black evening attire, Lord Napier wore a royal blue jacket over a white waistcoat. Lady Napier's dress was also characteristically idiosyncratic. Rather than trying to compete with her wealthy friends, she had chosen to wear a white silk gown decorated with tulle and edged in black lace. You did not hear ladies say of her, as of so many others, "What a splendid dress! How much did it cost?" commented the New York Times reporter. When will women learn that to beauty and perfection of attire, cost is but a small essential? The gallant journalist was clearly ignorant of the sartorial revolution that had taken place during the previous year. On the inside, every woman of means was wearing one of W.S. Thompson's new steel crinoline cages. On the outside, they were experimenting with the new range of colors made possible by the invention of synthetic dye. Even Queen Victoria was not immune to the changes in fashion and had worn mauve to the wedding of her eldest daughter, Princess Victoria, to Prince Frederick of Prussia in January 1858. Lady Napier's elegant but austere dress reflected none of these developments and yet still managed to cause a sensation, not only on account of its simple design, but also because amid the unavoidable clash of magentas and fuchsias, the pure white cast all other colors in the shade. The enmity that had begun to poison social life in Washington went into suspension during the ball. The crush was so great that dancing had to take place in relays, the guests jamming the bars and corridors while they waited their turn to enter the ballroom. Decorated veterans from the Mexican War chatted sociably with bankers from New York, and the broad vowels of Mississippi intermingled with the clipped tones of Massachusetts. The reigning queens of society made a rare collective appearance. Mrs. John Slidell and Mrs. Rose Greenhow rotated around each other like brilliant stars, their orbits passing close by, but never quite touching. It was said by Mrs. Greenhow's rivals that she adorned the British legation in much the same way as Lord Nelson's mistress, Lady Hamilton, had adorned his ship. Among the few who were missing from the ball was President Buchanan, who remained at home with a head cold. William Lowndes Yancey of Alabama was also indisposed. This was perhaps fortunate, since his booming voice could overpower a brass band, particularly when warming to his twin obsessions of slavery now and slavery forever. Charles Francis Adams, the congressman-elect from Massachusetts, had also stayed away, despite his family's long association with British-American diplomacy. Adams despised small talk, hardly drank, and never danced. Not even the disappointment of his wife Abigail could overcome his reluctance to attend. Charles Francis Adams's grandfather, John Adams, the second president of the United States, and father, John Quincy Adams, the sixth president, had both served as ministers plenipotentiary to the court of St. James's. One of the highlights of the evening came when Lord Frederick Cavendish, second son of the seventh Duke of Devonshire, and the Honorable Evelyn Ashley, step-grandson of the former Prime Minister Viscount Palmerston, walked onto the dance floor. There were frissons among the debutantes as the two bachelors repaid many debts of hospitality accrued during their tour of America by dancing into the small hours of the morning. However, it was only in retrospect that the Napier Ball became famous, not for its exalted guests or its lavish banquet, but as the last time Northerners and Southerners socialized together before the war. Lord Napier's replacement as the senior British diplomat in America, Lord Lyons, arrived in Washington at the beginning of April 1859. Even by English standards, the 42-year-old Richard Bickerton Pamell Lyons was an eccentric character. Any display of emotion, including his own, made him uncomfortable. Women and servants tended to suffer from an excess of it, in his opinion, which made him dread close contact with either. He was reluctant to look people in the eye and knew the shoes and stockings of his servants far better than their faces. Though not a killjoy, Lyons had never developed a taste for alcohol, and smoking made him ill. This was less of a handicap in Europe, where his witty and erudite conversation made him a favorite of hostesses. But in Washington, his lack of interest in cigars and whiskey simply accentuated his strangeness. Napier did his best for Lyons during the short time they overlapped at the legation.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.